Congress reaches a compromise in hopes of steering the country from the fiscal cliff. But what will it mean for your pocketbook? The compromise also extended the farm bill, but what do Mahaska County experts say it'll mean for farmers and consumers? And who did local parties pick as their candidates for the open Mahaska County Supervisor seat? CRI has the answers.
From Oskaloosa's television news source, CRI Weekly News starts right now.
Thanks for joining us. I'm Amy Langdon. Financial planners and certified public accountants in Oskaloosa have been fielding calls from clients all week about the so-called fiscal cliff. That term refers to what could have happened to taxes and government spending if certain federal laws, including the Bush-era tax cuts, were allowed to expire with the new year. A last-minute deal by Congress may have helped many Americans dodge a bullet, but as CRI's Jason Madison tells us, it's not the end of Washington's battle over the country's finances.
On this vote, the yeas are 257. The nays are 167.
Without a deal, taxes would have risen by more than $500 billion in 2013, as almost every tax cut enacted since 2001 was set to expire. Middle-income households would have seen an average tax increase of almost $2,000, according to the Tax Policy Center, a bipartisan organization. Some of the pluses of the current agreement are tax rates won't change, it renewed the child care credit, a non-refundable tax credit for unreimbursed child care expenses, along with the education credit, a type of tax credit available to students of post-secondary education institutions such as colleges or universities. And lastly, the bill kept unemployment benefits intact. Nevertheless, one of the most immediate and visible impact of the deal is a 2% payroll tax increase for all working citizens.
This is not getting a lot of media coverage right now.
Dave Fitch, a certified public accountant with TD&T Financial Group in Oskaloosa, says about 2 years ago, Congress gave everyone a payroll tax holiday for 2 years. It basically reduced the amount of Social Security tax taken out of each paycheck from 6.2% to 4.2%.
So we've been enjoying that. Of course, the theory behind that was let's stimulate the economy and the economy will get going and then eventually we'll go back to the old rules.
Extending the holiday tax was batted around, but it didn't have support. So starting with the first check of the year, everyone who earns wages will see a 2% reduction in his or her take-home pay. For example, if you usually make $800 every 2 weeks, you will see $16 less in each paycheck. According to Fitch, this increase will impact more than 70% of workers in the U.S.
So that's going to be an interesting thing to kind of watch and see how that impacts our economy. And because if you think about how people spend money, if I have 2% less in take-home pay, maybe I don't have that extra cup of coffee today. Maybe I don't go out to dinner this weekend with my family. Now, on the other hand, you know, it deals with Social Security, so Social Security as a plan or a program is in significant amount of trouble. So it's kind of one of those things where you give somebody something and people love to have more, but when you have to take it away, it's kind of like getting bad medicine.
While many of the deep fiscal cliff spending cuts were postponed in the new law, Congress has yet to complete work on that side of the budget. For CRI Weekly News, I'm Jason Madison.
With the tax component resolved for the moment, Congress still has two more hurdles to deal with. First, the debt ceiling, which is the maximum amount the U.S. government can borrow at any time. Second, sequestration, the action of taking legal possession of assets until a debt has been paid or other claims have been met. Dave Fitch urges citizens to not be bystanders and to correspond with their representatives from now until the end of February to make their voices heard. The fiscal cliff package also prevented some increases to the estate tax. The bill ensures taxes won't be collected on inheritances of $5 million or less. This is good news for family farms for whom a high estate tax means they may have to sell off part of their farms to pay the tax as farms pass from one generation to the next. But for inheritances of more than $5 million, the tax levy goes up from 35 to 40%. And even more good news for farmers was the extension of the farm bill. The expiration of the farm bill would have meant cuts to farmer subsidies and a lot of uncertainty as farmers plan for next year's crop. CRI's Aaron Riggs explains what the extension means for not just farmers, but for all of us.
In simple terms, the Farm Bill allots subsidies to farmers in order to make food affordable for consumers and farming profitable for farmers. Congress voted on an extension of the Farm Bill Tuesday night.
They passed a one-year extension of the current Farm Bill that we've been under for the last 4 years.
This means farmers can know what to expect for the year ahead as they make farming decisions in 2013.
It gives the farmer and his banker a little direction that we can, you know, make for better planning.
But since it's only a one-year extension, it's not ideal.
The same questions we had going into 2012 are still here in 2013.
Because farmers rely on programs like the Farm Bill to make long-term decisions.
And when decision-making gets harder, the likelihood of profitability is also affected.
And for the consumer, an extended Farm Bill means affordable prices at the supermarket, especially for milk.
Part of that bill includes dairy subsidies, and it prevents the price of milk going sky high to the consumer.
Because when a Farm Bill extension expires, the original law from the 1930s takes over.
So if you indexed it off of 1930s inflation, milk would be like $16 a gallon versus what it is now.
Beef prices, however, will still be going up due to farmers liquidating their herds last year as a response to the higher corn prices caused by the drought.
A lot of people sold more than they would have in a normal year because of the drought. And we're talking specifically about cows.
Wells says you can expect the price of beef in 2013 to go up 1% more on top of inflation. For CRI Weekly News, I'm Aaron Riggs.
As the Farm Bill debate continues into this year, you can voice your opinion on the matter by writing your representatives in Washington or by joining a trade organization. Some slightly warmer temperatures ahead. Here's a look at your five-day forecast. There will be an empty seat on the County Board of Supervisors when current Supervisor Ken Rosenboom heads to Des Moines to take his place in the state Senate. Local political parties met this week to choose who they'd like to see take his place. The Mahaska County Democrats met at Wednesday evening at Smoky Row Coffee House, and they had only one candidate in mind, former Oskaloosa Mayor and State Senator Tom Riley. Riley ran for County Supervisor in November, but lost to Republican Mike Vander. Riley says the decision to run again took some soul searching.
I did an awful lot of going back and forth. We ran what I thought was a good campaign, and the general election came up a little bit short. I took some time to reassess everything. Also had a lot of conversations with a number of different people again, and even people that I really wouldn't even consider. Still were coming to encourage me. Hey, just, you know, hang in there and try for this special election. I think, again, just as I said in the general, I think I still have some things that I can offer.
The Mahaska County Republicans met Thursday evening at the Mahaska County Courthouse. Two candidates were nominated for the seat, Mark Doland and Joe Warwick. Doland, a local minister and active member of the local Republicans, won the vote 39-7.
We have a very short time to try to put a team together. I have some things in place that I've been working on ahead of time. However, not knowing who would be the nominee puts me at a little bit of a disadvantage. However, I have somebody who's a vendor for signs. I have all that kind of stuff designed, and we have a team together to do some phone calling and door knocking. This will be a grassroots campaign, and we're going to try to get our message out, and we're excited to have the nomination, and I thank Joe Warwick for running, and either one would have made a good candidate, however.
Both parties had to have their nominations turned in by Friday. The special election will be held on January 29th. Polls will be open from 7 a.m. to 9 p.m. Wednesday's county supervisors meeting had some firsts and lasts. It was Ken Rosenboom's last as a county supervisor, but the meeting was also the first for newly elected Mike Vander. I sat down with Vander to find out the direction the board is heading and how he's prepared for the job. So you were sworn in yesterday as a county supervisor. How did it feel after all the work?
Well, I mean, it was a big journey to get there, but I was really glad to get started, and I spent my first day in the supervisor's office and got a lot of ideas I want to move forward. So, but yeah, I'm excited to get started.
So how did you prepare? How did you work so you can hit the ground running?
Well, I've been attending supervisor meetings for over a year now, and I just try to familiarize myself as much as I could with that role, and I've been to committee meetings with other supervisors and just sort of followed what they kind of walked in their shoes, I guess. And I think that's really going to pay off here in the next year.
So you're starting just in time to work on the budget.
Yep.
You got a lot of budget meetings ahead, a lot of planning. How's that process going?
We're going to sit down with all the department heads next week, and so they're going to give us, you know, what they think they need for a budget, and there'll be a little back and forth there. But we need to, you know, make sure we keep our, you know, tax levies as low as possible, but we still need to give basic services to our citizens.
So what's the, and I understand you're fairly new, so you mm-hmm. maybe can't speak too much to this, but what's the priority this year? Are there any, you know, big projects you guys are starting to budget for?
I don't think there's anything. Well, I know one thing long term is the conservation facility, the educational facility. We're going to have to figure out what we're going to do there, if we're going to maybe include some of the local option sales tax money, put that towards that in the future. But we're going to have to figure out how we're going to fund that facility if it does get done. So that's a big one, but that's a ways off. But really, next week is going to be the day-to-day operations of the different departments around the county and making sure that they have what they need, but they don't have more than what they need. So
one of the topics that's been happening at county supervisors is the creation of a local hazmat team. How do you think, if at all, that'll benefit the community?
Well, it'll be good because we can get our response times a little bit better. Right now, we contract with the Ottumwa Fire Department in a group called Surge, and I think there's 2-hour response times for when we do have hazmat incidents, and that's pretty high. But here we can have locally trained firefighters in Oskaloosa and New Sharon and down in Cedar Township, and we can give them hazmat training. We can buy the materials they need for hazmat responses. But in the long term, because we're not going to be paying that entity in Ottumwa, I believe we budget $18,000 for that each year. We're not going to be paying that. After several years, we'll be able to pay off that upfront money we're going to have to pay. So I think it's really a home run for the county. It's just a matter of planning it well and getting the implementation done.
And it keeps a lot of money locally. Is that a priority of the board?
Yeah, it is. Anytime you can do something locally as opposed to outsource it out of county or you know, out of state, I think it's a benefit to the county. So we try to do that as much as possible.
So you guys are about to have another empty seat on the board. Ken Rosenboom's last day, I believe, is January 11th. Yep. So you're new. There's going to be a new person. How do you think that's going to affect the work that the board's trying to do, having two new people on the board?
Well, it's just important to familiarize yourself as much as we can with the role and asking a lot of questions. And I do ask a lot of questions, a lot of things I don't know. So it's important for me to learn as much as I can and to know who to go to for questions. I've already been in the auditor's office quite a few times asking them, you know, some of the ins and outs of what's going on. So I'm trying to familiarize myself as much as possible with the role and with the budgeting process and as things go forward. But I look forward to working with whoever fills Ken's seat. I think that election is going to happen on the 29th of January. Mm-hmm. So you know, a little more than 3 weeks away here, and then that person will be sworn in really soon. So whoever fills that role, I look forward to working with them.
So last question for you. What are you most excited about now that you're a county supervisor?
Well, a lot of it is, I mean, I can start to help people and I can sort of implement some ideas and do so in a responsible fashion. I mean, there's a few items that's going to take a little money up front, but I think in the long term we can save money, like hazmat. But I'm just looking forward to getting started and learning as much as I can and managing things well.
Also at Wednesday's meeting, Sue Brown was sworn in as county auditor and Paul DeGeese was sworn in as sheriff. Supervisor Greg Gordy will stay in his role as board chairperson, with Vander Molen serving as vice chairperson. Coming up next, the George Daly Auditorium gets a new youth director. CRI has all the details.
For the latest news about your community, visit CRITV.org. Learn what happened at city council meetings. Stay up to date on county supervisors. Search for past news stories. Watch the latest videos. Comment on stories you care about. Share stories on Facebook and Twitter. Vote in our interactive poll or just meet the CRI team. CRITV.org delivers all the news and resources about your community. So stay up to date on the news that affects you and visit CRITV.org.
The George Daly Auditorium has a new youth theater director. Aaron Riggs introduces us and has details on Daly's plans for the children's theater this year.
Andy McGuire grew up in Boone, Iowa, graduated in 2010 from Central College in Pella, and has since worked at eight theater companies prior to becoming the youth theater director at the George Daly in Oskaloosa.
It's kind of like a dream job for me. And on top of that, Oskaloosa has some really fantastic opportunities.
Opportunities like a children's theater program that, for children, are rare in a small community. In the program, McGuire says he tries to use skills that complement the education students receive in school.
We really want to hit those team-building, creativity skills before we hit anything else. Those things end up being really helpful, especially when schools push math and science and reading.
And Oskaloosa children will get to show off their skills the week of January 14th, when the Missoula Children's Theater comes to town to put on the production of The Secret Garden.
A company takes two working professionals, a director and usually an assistant director, but they both work together to cast a community performance for kids kindergarten through 12th grade.
Auditions will be on the 14th with the performance on Saturday the 19th. And then, starting in February, first through eighth graders will get the chance to hone their talent during the Daly's after school program.
And our first session is going to be movement in theater. We always like to stress in theater, you want to show a story before you tell a story. So that's where we're starting with our first session. We want to be showing what's happening before you tell.
And McGuire says you don't have to be a natural to have a good time.
One of the big things we want to stress in the program is everyone has a place, no matter their skill level, no matter what their comfortableness is. So we really want to hit that individual attention to every student.
For CRI Weekly News, I'm Aaron Riggs.
To learn more about the Children's Theater Program, you can contact Andy McGuire by phone or email. And that's the CRI Weekly News for this week. Our next newscast is Friday at 6:30 p.m. on MCG Channel 12. But until then, don't forget to check us out online at CRITV.org and follow us on Facebook and Twitter for news during the week. We leave you now with a look at the past week through photos provided by our coverage partner, OSCENews.org. From all of us at the Communication Research Institute of William Penn University, thank you for watching. I'm Amy Langdon. See you next week.
Happening in Oskaloosa by following CRI Weekly News online at www.CRITV.org, facebook.com/CRI Weekly News, and Twitter at CRI Oskaloosa.